Welcome, everybody. Panel on EU securitization regulation, which may actually be a bit of a reprieve relative to the volatility that we're seeing happening in the US markets and actually globally as well. So perhaps we can relax on this topic and take some comfort in it even, perhaps. And I'll tell you, I definitely am with this panel of experts here to my left. Each one of them I've been very impressed with and actually humbled with how much they know relative to myself. So I will have very little value to add, other than perhaps at times to kind of keep the conversation going. I think we have a lot to cover. We have a number of different topics we want to hit. So I'll go ahead and get started. And one thing we wanted to do at the beginning, just to help give us a little bit of direction in terms of who's in the room, you know, what your perspective on this issue is. Are you more interested in the investor's plight in this, or more interested in the issuer's plight in this, or somewhere in between? So we actually have a polling question along those lines, and hopefully that's teed up for us. And the way you access and the way you complete it is actually to go on, if you've got the app, that's the key way to do it. So you've got the app, kind of scroll down on that, and you'll see the polling question, and that's how you'd be able to, there it is, teed up. So I guess whenever you have a chance, if you can, plug that in, that'll help us tailor our comments a little bit. So with that being said, I'm Dave Goodson. I work for Voya Investment Management. I'm on the decidedly on the investor side of the equation, but we're absolutely here to talk about, you know, the kind of the complete picture. I manage all of our securitized products, and this issue is something that's near and dear to our heart because we have significant amounts of European capital that we manage, and we want to do it, obviously, in compliance with the law. And that's not exactly clear, at least from an investor's perspective, how you do that. So again, we've got these experts here to help us with that. So with the polling done, I'll go ahead and ask for the gentleman here to my left to introduce himself. So just start with you, Alex, first, if you don't mind.
Alexander Bachlerov, Bank of America. I'm based in London, and I'm responsible for non-US structured finance research. So my team covers Europe, Asia, Australia, and so on.
Richard Hopkin. I'm head of fixed income at the Association for Financial Markets in Europe, or AFMI for short. We are a trade association that represents Europe's wholesale banks, and in particular, I would say that we lead the field in the topic of securitization regulation, which is what I spend most of my time on, with the support of my members like Alex and David and others here at in this conference. I've sort of worked on this securitization regulation for the best part of the last 10 years now.
Hi, I'm David Carollo. I'm a partner at Cadwalader Wickersham & Taft in London. I work mostly in the CLO securitization space, also asset-backed lending, and I also assist the Loan Markets Association on lobbying efforts around securitization regulation in Europe.
I'm Charlie Sweet. I'm a partner in the Washington, D.C. office of Morgan Lewis, where I represent issuers and underwriters and all kinds of U.S. asset-backed and RMBS securities. And so I deal with these issues from the side primarily of U.S. issuers and underwriters. I'm also the co-author of Offerings of Asset-Backed Securities, which is one of the most up-to-date treatises about U.S. securities regulations as they affect our industry.
I'm Chris Walsh, partner at Clifford Chance in our Global Financial Markets Group, and specialize primarily in residential mortgage financing across Europe and Asia and Australia.
Perfect, gentlemen. Well done. So I thought we'd get started with maybe a little bit of a retrospective, which, in talking with my panelists, not a lot has really changed overall year over year in terms of the concepts of the law. But again, just to make sure we're all on the same page and have the right perspectives here, I thought maybe I could start with Richard, with his extensive role in lobbying around this law. Could you kind of walk us through what that process was like legislatively, all the different moving parts? This is the part where it blows my mind what's having to be balanced in Europe as it relates to this law. If you could give us some retrospective
sure.
history on that, would be great.
Yeah, thank you. There are times when it blows mine as well. I'll try and avoid giving, you know, a lecture about European constitutional law, but I'll just try and hit the high spots of the legislative process, you know, maybe unfamiliar to those of you who don't live in Europe. Essentially, the securitization regulation is a regulation of the European Council and the European Parliament. So it's an instrument of law that's created at the European level The European Union is a supranational organization. So when it passes laws, these laws apply directly in all the member states of the EU without the national legislators in each of the member states having to do anything. There are sort of three parts to the process, or three main bodies. There's the European Commission, which is an unelected organization. It's made up of civil servants. It's quite technocratic. The important thing to bear in mind about the Commission is that it has the sole and exclusive ability to propose new laws. So you can't create any new laws at the European level unless the Commission proposes them. Then you have two other bodies, the Council, which is made up of the individual member states, and then the European Parliament, which is a directly elected parliament, which has to review and approve all these things. So the process of this regulation was sort of quite long and fraught. The original draft proposed by the Commission was actually, in my opinion, not a bad draft. The Commission did a pretty good job. They completely understand securitization. They know what it does, why it's important. Unfortunately, what then happened was that it got rushed through the member states stage with the Council. It got rushed through in about 6 weeks. And then it got bogged down in the European Parliament, where an awful lot of changes were made to it. End result, and this is by no means unique to this regulation, it's kind of how things tend to work with most regulations at the EU level, is a regulation which kind of more or less works, but is, I think, very heavy, very restrictive, and often difficult to interpret. I'll leave it there for now, because I think we'll probably come on to talk about the areas where we think perhaps some adjustments might be necessary.
Terrific. Thank you, Richard. Maybe another point would be, this is somewhat also just kind of perspective setting. And I got some interesting feedback from Chris actually yesterday towards the end, so maybe I'll ask him to speak on this specifically. What is intended to be in scope of the law specifically? And the part I found most interesting in our dialogue yesterday, Chris, was around from an issuer's perspective, what types of deals, but secondly, and this could be open to any of the other panelists as well, what about from an investor's perspective? What types of arrangements are intended to be in scope of the law? But Chris, I'll ask you to start.
Yeah, I think that's an important point, because I think there's a real difference between how US legislation works here and EU legislation, is what is a securitization, and thus what comes under the ambit of the EU securitization regulations. Primarily, you are looking at loan portfolios and finance receivables where there is a tranching of that debt, where you have a differing probability of loss, and probability of loss rather than severity of loss, as a result of those tranchings. What that means is, unlike US securitizations, Charles, you can correct me if I get any of this wrong,
I will.
is that basically if you have an asset-backed security, so it can be a single tranche transaction, you fall kind of within the regulations, depending on X, Y, and Z exemptions. In the EU, if you had a single tranche securitization, as we would all know a securitization, it would never be within the EU securitization regulations. Equally, if you are securitizing the operations of a shopping center or warehouses where it's all one corporate risk, again, it wouldn't be a securitization. So a good example of what is and what isn't a securitization is if you look at aircraft financing and lease financing. If you have 10 aircraft, they're all leased to British Airways, and you've got a series of tranchings of debt, that would not be, for the purposes of the regulations, largely a securitization for a variety of reasons, but including that you look through and say, well, the probability of default is purely based on is British Airways still here or not, and that whilst you may have severity of loss in different ways, and your most subordinated tranche taking a bigger loss, the chances of them all suffering a loss are the same. If you, however, then take those 10 aircraft and say, actually, five are British Airways, five are Delta, then immediately you have a difference there, because British Airways could carry on and Delta could go in insolvency and vice versa. And then you have a difference on probability of loss as well as severity of loss, and now you are a securitization for EU securitization regulations. So immediately in terms of what is in the scope of these deals, it is a more nuanced and sophisticated look than that you have to do, rather than just going, oh, this is a securitization, it's got tranching, etc.
Also loans, right?
And loans, yeah. I mean, right. Absolutely, loans, etc.
Whereas under the U.S. rules, if your financial interest that you're issuing are loans as opposed to a security, the risk retention rules don't apply.
Yeah,
that's not true.
Absolutely, yes. So it's not just bonds; it's anything with tranche debt. So loans, if you have two loans, equally if you have one debt, one recognized debt, a bond or a loan, and you have the right to deferred purchase price. That deferred purchase price, if contractually done, is a tranche for these purposes, and you fall into the securitization regulations.
What about from an investor's perspective? Are there any arrangements for, say, US-based investors managing European money that could be expected to be considered out of scope for the reg, or is it intended to be very comprehensive? Anybody have a good perspective on that?
I mean, this definition of securitization is broad, one of the issues that you have with European regulation a lot of the time is what's written on the page and how it's being interpreted by European regulators can be quite different. They really, like, meeting after meeting, it's the spirit of the regulation. So we've seen transactions where, you know, you're not tranching the contractual tranching of debt, so you have a debt instrument and equity, where people would still consider it a securitization. So I think anytime there's tranching, European investors need to consider whether that is a securitization, even if it's not contractual tranching in the sense, it's very easy to create a structure which has the same economic effect of a securitization, but you do it in debt and equity. And, European investors are sensitive to that because of this focus on the spirit of the regulation.
And I think one other important point to bring to people's attention is the scope of who falls in with the European securitization regulations, and I think this is where we'll probably start to discuss in more interest, is that you are only subject to the EU securitization rules if you are an EU individual for these purposes. So that means a US issuer does not automatically become subject to it. It's not subject to the sanctions and fines regimes.
Automatically, right.
I mean, it was small asterisks of if you're a large international bank and you've got both regulatory oversight in Europe and the US, it's a more complicated story. But primarily, if you were purely based in the US and you're a US issuer, the EU securitization regulations doesn't apply. You won't get fined or anything. However, if you sell into Europe, your European investor, being in Europe, is subject to it. So whilst the US issuer does not have to comply, does not get fined if he doesn't comply, his investor will have to comply and will get fined, potentially, if there isn't a compliant structure.
And that's often really hard for US folks to wrap our heads around, because yep. Our rules just don't apply that way. They don't have that kind of indirect application where an investor can sort of have the pressure to tell us what to do.
Yeah, absolutely.
They just have global effect.
Yeah.
Wonderful, guys.
Probably add that there's sure, probably ahead. One exception, which is more for the European banks, which have a subsidiary in the US. And these banks technically can invest in US product, which does not meet all the requirements of the EU securitization, but it has to be small volume relative to balance sheet and so on and so forth. And that's one of the exceptions, which is not in the securitization law from memory, but it's part of the banking regulation CRR.
Important point. Thank you, Alex. Maybe sticking with you as well, Alex, under the reg, one of the key provisions, as everybody, I'm sure, in the room is aware of, is risk retention. And complying for risk retention in the EU is very different in some cases from compliance with risk retention in the US. Could you give some more better fabric, deeper fabric, and if possible, if you could do it at the subsector level, i.e. for CMBS transactions, et cetera, how does that, what are the problems that issuers should have to deal with or face in achieving compliance?
Sure. One thing I want to mention from the very beginning is that the retention requirement in Europe is not new. It's not just enforced by the securitization regulation. The retention requirements in Europe were blanket requirements established back in 2011. And there were very few exceptions, mainly for legacy transactions for some period of time. But technically speaking, from memory, since 2014 or 2015, all legacy and new transactions, and all new transactions since 2011 had to comply with the retention requirement. The EU securitization regulation effectively rehashed that requirement and highlighted a few additional points. What are the main differences? I would say that the first difference is that EU retention requirement is for the life of the transaction. There is no sunset clause. There is no performance trigger or performance dependence and so on. So you have to have the retention for the life of the transaction. Number two, there are different formats of retention, and to my knowledge, probably the most, the one that is not accepted in Europe but exists in the US is a so-called L-shaped, 2.56 vertical and horizontal tranches. And the L-shaped retention is not acceptable at all in Europe. The other aspect is there should be some form of declaration for the retention in the documents of the transaction. So one of the points you asked to go through asset class is one of the things that kind of, and the lawyers here, I'm actually not the only non-lawyer on the panel, if I'm not mistaken.
Not really a proper lawyer.
Oh, but you were a former practicing lawyer. My colleagues, the lawyers here, probably will correct some of this in more technical terms, but my understanding is that in the transaction documents, the retention has to be specified for life, and it cannot change and so on. So one of the issues potentially is for U.S. credit cards, where the seller piece could be viewed as a retention and could meet the European requirements. The question is whether it's actually specified specifically. Defined in the transaction as such. The next issue is the retaining entity. The European regulators are very sensitive to the issue whether you are getting around the spirit, as a previous speaker indicated, of the regulation. So in that regard, there are two potential differences. One is financing of equity. We don't have anything in the regulation which bans the financing, but we know that some of the European regulators are a bit sensitive to that. And the second is, who is the retaining entity? Ideally, you want it to be the originator or sponsor, basically an entity which is involved with the transaction throughout its life, involved in the assets, and so on. There were some controversies in Europe with regards to retention under MiFID or under other regulations. But overall, the point is that you need to have that equity entity clearly specified, closely involved with the transaction, and remaining in place for the life of the deal. Maybe my colleague lawyers will give a bit more legalistically technical clarification.
I mean, what I would say to just in other differences as well, I don't know if there's anyone that works in the CMBS space, but the third-party yes. purchaser option for risk retention in CMBS transactions doesn't work in Europe, which is a big difference, in terms of selling CMBS into Europe.
Representative sample, there's effectively, as I understand it, a representative sample option in the EU rules. You can't do that in the US at all. The EU rules allow synthetic satisfaction of risk retention. We don't, in the US. We also spend a lot of time talking about majority-owned affiliates in the U.S. because our sponsors that retain, and by the way, sponsor doesn't mean the same thing in the EU as in the U.S., so that's another source of confusion. Our clients often want to, use this majority-owned affiliate concept to figure out different ways that they might sort of finance parts of their risk retention interests, and there's no such concept in the EU rules. So there really are a lot of differences.
Yeah, I think they are. I mean, I think the general story is the same. I wouldn't say that risk retention, though, does pose, I mean, I think whilst there are differences, I think we'd probably all agree of they're pretty surmountable differences of mm-hmm. that you generally don't get a transaction failing these days because you can't find your suitable risk retention holder.
It's just after when your way through
exactly. You're exactly right, Charles. It's more you just got to be careful and plan it at the beginning of the transaction and create the right story and fact pattern for compliance. But I think it's one of the pieces of the regulations, as was said, that's been in place for a while. It's fairly well bedded down now, and there's not that many grey issues now, and people are pretty comfortable with how that's implemented.
Maybe tying one thing together that I picked up early on about what's in scope, with a comment, David, you made about CMBS transactions, mm-hmm. the risk retention piece not translating nicely and neatly mm-hmm. into the EU securitization reg. Would single asset, single borrower CMBS deals potentially be viewed as not in scope, and therefore not have the problems with risk retention around CMBS not be applicable to that portion of the CMBS market? Am I appreciating that properly?
Yeah, I mean, that's absolutely right. I mean, a single asset, single borrower real estate securitization, CMBS would not be a securitization for EU securitization purposes. Now, a point to note is that, and this is where it comes back to EU investors being comfortable, EU investors are now we get feedback regularly of, but they still kind of like to see that skin in the game. And so you sometimes have trouble when doing single tranche deals in Europe purely of, well, are you really sure it's not a securitization? And even if you are really sure, well, why can't we have the 5% piece anyway? And it doesn't really make sense. The concept doesn't work when you're sort of like financing a shopping center where it's all based on loan to value anyway of what you're raising, and there's plenty of skin in the game in my view. But you're right that those types of transactions don't impact us at all from a regulatory point of view.
Everybody agree with that?
Absolutely. Just one additional point, which is related to the CLO market. Effectively, the withdrawal of retention in the U.S. CLO market excluded a big portion of the U.S. CLOs from European investor access and European investor scope. So many of U.S. CLOs now we do provide retention, and it's basically specifically in order to reach European investor base. We are going to talk about another angle of the European regulation later on, which basically means that just meeting the retention requirement by US CLOs in a few months may not be sufficient to be able to sell to European investor base, and that's the issue with disclosure, which will come next.
Let's talk about that. So almost in the same vein, how we just discussed how risk retention requirements under the EU reg may not fit as neatly for US issuers. Similarly, from a disclosures and ongoing reporting standpoint, that is a piece that I've come to appreciate directly from issuers in the US. How do you comply with that? And the part that I've appreciated mostly from the issuer standpoint is lack of appreciation for exactly what is going to be required. Is that authentic thinking in your mind? Is that real? Or should at this point issuers have enough clarity on the reporting piece?
Well, my personal view is that we don't have a final answer.
Right.
And the European regulators have been a bit quiet on that. So just to define the problem, the European regulation for securitization has a requirement about due diligence, and that requirement is linked to data disclosure. The well-discussed Article 5 and 7 of the securitization regulation. So the question about the disclosure is, it is clear that it is requirement for European securitizations to provide loan-by-loan disclosure in line with a template provided by European Securities Market Authority, ESMA. Those templates are pretty much finalized, and we expect them to be voted very soon and go into force sometime this spring. So from that moment on, they'll be mandatory for all European issuers, European investors to use when they issue securitization or carry out the due diligence on a securitization transaction. Because of a little text in Article 7 which says where applicable, one of the question marks is now is whether these templates are applicable for non-EU issuers when they're accessing the European investors. And there are different views among the legal community. One thing that everybody seems to agree on is that the templates themselves will not be mandatory for non-EU issuers. What is not clear is whether loan-by-loan disclosure would be required for non-EU issuers when they access EU-based or EU-regulated investors, and what does loan-by-loan disclosure involve? Does it have to be exactly the same as the European requirements, the European templates require? Should it be essentially the same? What kind of issue there will be? There is a third element of the disclosure, which is the data repository. We're getting in a bit of a strange period in Europe because the ESMA templates will be in force sometime this spring. However, the repositories probably won't be up and running until I would suspect December this year or January next year. That raises several interesting questions. Number one, where do the templates post it? But more importantly, the repository has to perform some function of verification of the data or the way the template is filled in. And that would leave probably 8, 10, maybe even 12 months when that process won't really happen. There won't be verification from the repository of the respective templates, but nonetheless, the templates will be out there. Investors will be able to use to carry out the due diligence. Some of you are probably aware that SFA sent a letter to the European regulators, I think it was April, May last year, they're still waiting for the response. We know that the European regulatory bodies have discussed the issue, but they feel that they cannot have an answer. The answer has been delegated by them to the European Commission. We understand that a lot of discussions are going on, even at the level of European Council. To summarize the problem, do you want to see the European regulators giving no requirement or releasing from loan-by-loan disclosure requirements of non-EU issuers when they're actually obliging, requiring the EU issuers to carry out that disclosure? That raises a bit of a question about level of playing field and a bit of competitiveness and so on. The second question is, if you have, let's say, 105 fields in Europe, and I think from memory, the Reg AB for mortgages in the US is what, 170 fields or 150 fields, are they substantially the same? If you use the US fields, is this enough? And so on and so forth. And what happens to those who cannot provide the disclosure of thousands of loans in their pools, are they automatically excluded from the European investor base? So there are quite a few issues there. I think the issue has been politicized quite a bit. So we are still waiting for response.
And it is quite a practical issue. I mean, you know, you mentioned Reg AB, but you know, there are a lot of deals and a lot of asset classes, including mortgages, which you mentioned in the US, where people aren't doing public deals and they aren't reporting asset level data. And it's not clear that they would be able to give anything like the types of asset level data that are required by the European templates. So, you know,
I mean, you
know, they're out, right?
Yeah. I mean, my view, having, you know, talk to regulators and a lot of lobbying along with Richard. I mean, one thing that came very clear from the rules was that the Commission and Parliament wanted more loan level information for investors, and I think we can't get away from that fact. You know, I think there's, you know, if I had to take bets, I think European investors are going to need substantially similar information. What that actually means at this point is unclear, and I'd also point out, you know, the UK, you know, at the end of the transition period, they've already published what the securitization regulation is going to look like in the UK, and it's very clear in those regulations that UK investors need to receive substantially similar information. So I think if we, you know, I think the best position we're going to be able to get in is maybe not to have to use the exact templates. Some of them don't work for US assets. But I do think people will need to look at the loan level reporting that they're giving investors. And some asset classes is not going to be a problem. If you look at, you know, CMBS, the CREFC reporting in the US, there's probably no other better example of substantially similar information. But what I don't think is going to work is you know, some asset classes where there's not a lot of loan level data, I don't see Europe giving U.S. deals a pass on that. I mean, they want the investors to have the information. The question's going to be, was what is substantially similar?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's absolutely right. I think the issue we have is that the regulations, even just for EU, it should be, remember that we're talking about it from a U.S. issuer context, but from an EU issuer context, the rules are not perfect for EU issuers. So right. Do not think that this is just U.S. issuers having to try and work out how to report. It's a big story and a big issue for EU issuers as to how to report. So, and I think the EBA and ESMA, et cetera, are focused on trying to get it to work internally because they've got the mess of trying to get these regulations correctly in place on a somewhat strange implementation period that wasn't well publicized and well thought out. But I think I think you have to put it in a political context because this is this regulation is a political piece of art. And I think you have to ask yourself the question of if you are a European politician, are you going to say to a European bank and to a European issuer who you've imposed a whole load of cost on, that actually non-EU issuers from Australia, from America, et cetera, can get in an easier way without the same level of surveillance and with banks being able to invest in, and I'm going to use the word dodgy in quotes, because that is the mind of a European politician at times, assets without at least the same level of thoroughness. And I think that's going to be, if we as an industry go down the view of trying to argue that, yes, we should have exemptions for non-EU issuers, I don't think we'll succeed. I think the right hunting ground for us to be in is to say, look, people are different. The way that loan markets have been brought up in different countries is different as to how they look at things. But fundamentally, if you can deliver the level of information that investors need to make an informed decision, that is where we should be.
Now, and that may well foreclose some U.S. issuers in some programs from issuing into the EU.
It may very well do so.
Things that have been dealt with on a market power basis to date, right, when we don't have quite so much clarity from the EU side, you know, issuer says, I'm providing you with some information, make up your own mind as to whether EU investor as to whether you've got enough. EU investor might say, fine, if it really wants the bonds, or it might decide that it's a little bit more conservative and then say, well, I need more information, and then it's really going to be dealt with by how much does the U.S. issuer really need to sell into the EU markets.
Yeah.
And we may lose some of that back and forth.
Yeah, and I from a European point of view, I'd answer that with, well, there's nothing new from that from an EU issuer wanting to go into the U.S. markets.
Right.
So do you want to do the additional level of cost that a 10b5 143A exercise in cost in going into the U.S.? It's kind of the flip side of that, I think, that we're looking at.
We've seen that in the CLO market. In the CLO market, I mean, U.S. CLOs issue into Europe when the pricing's right. You know, when U.S. risk retention went away for CLOs, you know, some U.S. CLOs still continue to hold retention when the pricing worked. And I don't see, generally speaking, you know, people look at the pricing. If the pricing makes sense and they can get better pricing, having European investors, they might look at it.
Yeah. I think one other thing that is important also to flag, just drawing it slightly away from reporting requirements, but is another important thing just to make U.S. issuers aware, and this is more the pain for lawyers than anyone else, is you have, obviously, we're talking right now about ongoing disclosure requirements. There's also day one disclosure requirements. You've got to make available on a website pre-pricing both the prospectus and all the primary transaction documents. And I think that is, it was a shock to EU issuers. It certainly was a shock to EU lawyers who all of a sudden had to close the entire deal before it was documented, before it was priced. But that is something from an EU issuer, from a US issuer perspective, that they will still need to comply with as well. And it's one of those small things that can trip up a US issuer in trying to access the EU markets.
Yeah, I mean, maybe I could just round off perhaps this part of the discussion with, a little bit of comment from the policy aspect of this. I think, I broadly agree with pretty much everything that's been said. I think it's fair to say when the regulation was going through, very little time was spent considering what should be the disclosure requirements for securitizations coming from outside the EU to EU investors. The focus is on many other things. Second of all, because of the nature of the legislative process, particularly in the Parliament, there's always a little bit of an element of trade-off. You know, you give me this and I'll give you that, but we need actually both of these things for this to work. That's not how it works. And essentially, because we as an industry were dealing with some voices in the Parliament who are trying to put risk retention up to as much as 30%, for example, we had to give a little bit of ground on some aspects of disclosure. You know, frankly, my personal view is that you won't find any sector anywhere else in the world, I don't think, that has as tough disclosure requirements as European securitizations right now. You know, you can fill your boots with, you know, North Korean equities if you want, and you don't have to meet anything like, you know, the disclosure requirements in European securitization. I think it's worth also pointing out that I never came across any kind of animus against securitizations from outside the EU, certainly not from the Commission. And the original draft of the EU securitization regulation actually was took a fairly open approach on that. It was changed for the STS part of the framework at the council stage. It was became a little bit of a political football in the context of Brexit. And also, I'm afraid, you know, we're in this sort of rather messy situation at the moment, I think, because ESMA made things worse by deciding to interpret the disclosure requirements as applying in the same way for private deals as for public deals, which I would argue was never the intention. And if you read the level one text of the actual regulation, there's plenty of stuff in there that supports that statement. But ESMA chose to take a different view, and we've argued with them about that. But they won't budge. So, in particular for US CLO deals coming into Europe, that made that whole issue a lot more acute. I understand those transactions normally structured as private deals, as they would be defined under the EU securitization regulation. So if ESMA hadn't taken that view, life would be a lot easier right now for US CLO issuers into Europe. But they did. And as Alex said, I think the message has got through. I think the authorities are thinking carefully about this. I think we will see something from them, but quite what they will say, I don't know. I doubt very much that they will say, yeah, it's fine, you know, if you're issuing from outside the EU, you don't have to disclose anything at all, you know, because, you know, the whole reason we have this regulation is because the last time European investors filled their boots with certain US products, it didn't end very well. So, yeah,
allegedly.
We need to be reasonable.
I'll point out this question has consumed the most amount of time, and for good reason. I think this is the cutting edge issue as it relates to the EU securitization reg, in my estimation. So this is cutting edge content, guys, you are put in front of the audience. Well done. Moving on, though, what about enforcement of the law? What have we seen so far? What are your expectations? And what is the tone likely to be from regulators? Or is that an impossible question to address with any kind of certainty?
I mean, I think one of the interesting things is, you know, it's up to national regulators in Europe to audit transactions for people they're supervising. And I think there is varying levels of sophistication across EU national regulators. To be honest, my personal view is not that much was done under the previous regime. I think we're seeing, you know, I'm hearing a lot more questions from national regulators in Europe. Asking some pretty fundamental questions where, you know, I think, you know, most lawyers operating in this space would say are well-trodden, and they've been market practice, you know, going back to 2011. You know, my personal view is that as they propose, so if a national regulator has a question about interpretation, they basically go to the three European regulators who meet and they discuss. I guess my concern is that the number of questions that I know are being sent to the European regulators, how are they, you know, are they being asked in the right way? Are the national regulators clear on the structure? It goes to the EBA, ESMA, and EIOPA. They look at it and take a view. And again, on stuff which I think a lot of people would think was you know, well-trodden market practice. You know, we're seeing questions that even the UK regulators were submitting questions to the three regulators up until Brexit time. So, you know, it's going to be interesting to see, but I think one always needs to realize that you know, not every national regulator in Europe, you know, has the experience or sophistication on looking at these transactions. It varies across Europe.
Yeah, I think the one thing I would add, which is of some comfort to people, is that generally the EBA, which is the main police force, policeman for these regulations, they've done it fairly well in terms of where lawyers and bankers and issuers have pushed too far and have relied on the technical wording rather than the spirit and have ignored the spirit of the regulation. They haven't come down with a ton of bricks and heavy fines or anything like that. It's more of a, we've seen what you've done, very clever, don't do it again. There was a series of instances where issuers and rangers and lawyers were using the words of the text as to who could be an originator to create SPV originators. The EBA answered that by writing a letter saying, we've become aware of this, that's not how it's supposed to be. These are the guidelines for what we want to see. They're not formal regulations. This is more of a sort of like letter before action. Now, if you don't behave as a market, we'll regulate harder. So there is a good deal of self-regulation and self-behaving within the market. And I think that, I mean, the regulator wants to encourage a healthy market, and that's important to note, is that there is an inherent conflict within the EU on securitizations of, whilst there are some politicians that do not like anything finance-related and would consider some people and all people in this room probably evil, there are an awful lot of people that believe that we have all in this room a very useful role in financing Europe. And they want to encourage that and make sure that that happens. And the regulator is the person that has to try and balance that. And generally speaking, they've done quite a good job with some quite difficult interpretations of text, which the drafting was not perfect.
I mean, I agree on this, sorry.
Great, I was just gonna say from a US perspective, the whole dynamic is quite fascinating because, as you guys are aware, in the U.S., we have our risk retention rules as to which we've heard almost nothing from the regulators and have really mostly been left probably, you know, partially due to our own lack of conversations with the regulators because we don't want to know, maybe don't want to hear a bad answer, but we have almost no regulatory guidance other than the LSTA case on what our rules actually mean.
Yeah. I'm probably going to get in trouble with Esma for saying this, but I do agree with the EBA. I think the EBA really understood, took a lot of time understanding the securitization market. ESMA has a much bigger role in the regulation of securitizations now. My personal experience is that they haven't always been very supportive of securitization or have the in-depth knowledge that the EBA had. As I said, that's my own personal view, and ESMA will probably never talk to me again. But that's, you know, I'm anxious to see what role ESMA takes in the supervision now and how much influence they have, you know, given that they have a larger role in the regulation of securitizations.
Anybody else want to add to that?
It's also related to a question that's coming later on, but we can probably cover it here.
Sure.
What is probably important to understand from American perspective, the way the European regulation works is, after we discussed earlier how it's adopted, but in terms of implementation, there are three kind of bodies or three kind of levels one has to think about. One is the European supervisory agencies, ESMA, EIOPA, and EBA that were mentioned consistently here. They have established a working group on securitization. Theoretically, they're coordinating among themselves different rulemaking aspects of the regulation or interpretation aspects of the regulation, and that's whom we approached with the SFA letter back last year when we asked for some support or for some explanation. In addition to that, there is an entity called SSM, the Single Supervisory Mechanism, which sits at ECB level, European Central Bank, and actually supervises the 110-120 largest systemically important banks in Europe, which also plays an important role in the implementation of that regulation. My impression is that right now SSM is more interested in the synthetic securitization aspects, significant risk transfer, commensurate risk transfer, capital relief, and so on, rather than in the cash securitization itself. But everybody who is involved in the market knows that these two securitizations cannot be separated, so some aspects will be in common, and by getting involved in what is a significant risk transfer and how do we calculate capital, it will inevitably have a bearing from synthetic into cash format. And then the third aspect are the national regulators. The national regulators, however, may not be as influential when it comes to the large systemically important banks, which where the priority of the regular of supervision comes from SSM, but they will probably be communicating with SSM when it comes to imposing or interpreting some of its regulations to the smaller banks. So it's quite complex, but I think it's very important to understand how it works.
That's excellent. Transitioning, because we are starting to wind down on our time, and there's two other topics I definitely wanted to get everybody's perspective on, if possible in this time. The first one would be on Brexit. Now transitioning to Brexitus, we'll have an interim period, presumably until that's complete. How does the EU securitization regulation apply now and through this kind of interim period until Brexitus is complete? And then what's your outlook going forward?
I mean, right now there is no change. The rules are that the UK has formally left the European Union now. It is no longer a member state, but it is complying with member state rules and as if it is a member state for these purposes up until the 31st of December 2020, which means on the 1st of January next year, the rules cease to apply. And what then happens is interesting, because it depends. There is the free trade agreement that is being negotiated at the moment, and that is very much going to dictate exactly where we end up in a whole panoply of things, EU securitization regulations, covered bond regulations, how to buy and sell a lettuce in the and how to buy a car, to use of your mobile phone. Everything is up for play. I think the general rule is that the UK is ready for what is referred to as a hard Brexit, whereby the rules the UK would automatically adopt very similar on day one mirror rules. So on the 1st of January 2021, the UK will still look very like the EU rules. However, that is when things can change. And I think obviously the UK, in the statements that are coming out in terms of its wanting to reach free trade agreements with other countries, for example, the United States, and to be seen as a highly competitive country on the world stage, there are reasons why the UK has certainly in the past, and if you listen to the politicians currently, will want to try and make the UK a investor-friendly place. So you could see the UK moving away from some of these more technical bureaucratic rules to free up that. Who knows?
Anything to add? Okay, so last question, I guess, final minute here. Any thoughts on the potential? I know we're just talking about finalizing the reg, but any thoughts on the potential for change and future amendment? What would be timeframes for even to think that something could be amended as it relates to the reg?
I'll kick off with this one, if I may. The regulation already has built in one of the articles towards the end, an obligation for the Commission to undertake a review of the functioning of the regulation and prepare a report, if necessary, with draft legislation. That has to be done by the 1st of January 2022, which might sound a long way off, but it's just a little bit more than 18 months. It's so soon because the coming into effect of the regulation was delayed by about a year because it took a year longer to get through the European Parliament than everybody was originally expecting. But the date of the review wasn't put back, but the date of coming to force the regulation moved forward. So there's a kind of a shorter gap. So now is very much the time, I think, and AFME has already started to do this in terms of engaging with the European authorities, making proposals for aspects of the regulation which need adjustment to make it work better. There are also lots of things that need to be done in associated regulations to recognize the very high standard of the STS framework, for example, which we haven't really covered today. But there are a lot of things to do. As Alex says, I think the focus is going to be on that. And I also think, as Alex is saying, the focus is going to be on the renewal of the function of securitization as a risk transfer tool. This is a function of securitization that fell a little bit out of fashion immediately after the financial crisis for all kinds of reasons. But I think the European authorities can see that the European banking system really needs this because capital requirements on the balance sheet are only going in one direction, which is up. Europe is still too dependent on banks and not dependent enough on capital markets. Authorities in Europe look across the pond and they see, you know, America's financed 80% and the capital markets 20% by the banks, but the reverse in Europe. We need to get closer to how the US does these things. So I'm actually cautiously optimistic that I think we'll be able to make some positive progress in the next 12 to 18 months on some of these things.
Wonderful note to end on. Let's applaud these gentlemen for great content. Well done.